Hi everyone, my name is Abraham Sebek and welcome to SAT2 Chemistry. Okay, so in these lecture series, we're going to be doing all the problems for SAT2 Chemistry and go over each and every one of the topics. So we can prepare you for the test and also get you an 800 top score on the test. So first, let's go over the format of what we're going to see on the SAT2 to better prepare you. And the first thing is there's 85 questions on the exam and all you're given is 60 minutes. So you have about 42 seconds per question. So you have to keep moving, okay? So your knowledge, being like swift with chemistry and being able to just remember everything, that's gonna be really, really important. So these lectures are designed to do that for you. Next, the matching questions, okay? So the first part you get is 25 questions. They're all matching. So they'll give you like, for example, a few words, and then they'll give you a short statement that you have to match it with. 15 of the questions will be true and false, where they'll give you two statements, and you have to decide whether the first statement it correctly explains the second statement. All right, and this is unique only to the SAT2 chemistry, and they're numbered from 101 to 115. Then you have your multiple choice questions, okay, and that's a total of 45 questions. So the goal here is to maybe omit 5 questions the most, okay? I tell students all the time, if you have to, don't go over 5 omits. I would probably go 4 or 3. I've talked to people who've gotten 800s, okay? I myself have gotten an 800, and I remember not going over maybe 4 omits, if anything. And I made sure that I got these questions all correct, and then these are the ones where you want to save the omits for, if anything, unless you're totally clueless about any one of these, which you don't want to be. Okay, so the next thing is they give you a periodic table. You're given no calculator, okay, like it said on the previous slide, no calculator. The only thing you are given is this periodic table and nothing else. It gives you the atomic number, it gives you the atomic symbol, okay, and it doesn't give you the name like it says over here. It will not tell you what element is what. You're supposed to know that, so you should recognize that that's iron, for example, and Sn is tin and W is tungsten, and just be very, very familiar with this, where the metals are, where the non-metals are, where the halogens, the alkali metals, right? We got our noble gases and so forth. And we're gonna look at this a little closer. So let's just start talking about what is chemistry. And chemistry is the study of matter. And so over here I have solid, liquid, and gas phases for you just to get you opening up here. Matter comes in all three phases, right? But also matter is made up of atoms that then build up and become molecules. Those molecules can be compounds and so forth, all right? So chemistry also deals with whether or not it's quantitative or qualitative, okay? So they're both in chemistry. What this basically means is that measurements are done, okay? So in other words, that you can measure it with a quantity, some sort of number, okay? So that's what quantitative means. Qualitative means that we have to describe what exactly we're seeing. So let's say the solution is 500 milliliters, okay? And then we have it here in this round bottom flask, not used for measurement. We have to describe what this is, okay? So the solution is pink. The solution is clear, okay? Originally, maybe it's clear to see through, right? It's transparent, I should say. And other things that you might have noticed, you can note that the temperature, but then that would be quantitative. Okay, but we're looking at two types of data here, and so the reagent was brown, and so forth, okay? Let's take a look at how substances are broken down. And so, very nicely put here, we have matter, okay? And matter could either be a pure substance, or it could be a mixture. All right, now breaking them down even further, the pure substance was the periodic table of elements that we saw before, all right? And then sometimes those elements form compounds or molecules together. All right, and then we have the two types of mixtures. We have the homogeneous mixture and the heterogeneous mixture. The big difference between the two of these is that the homogeneous mixture is the same throughout. Okay, so this is the same, okay, we're gonna say throughout. While the heterogeneous mixture is different throughout. A great example of a homogeneous mixture would be milk. Milk is homogenized, right? It says the word homogeneous on it. It's a mixture of many things. It has fat, it has water in it, it has proteins in it. Okay, and so that has been blended in a certain way where it's the same throughout, it is homogenized. On the other hand, sometimes things are different throughout, like a salad, right? Or maybe some, let's say I put sand and water in the same glass, right? That's a heterogeneous mixture because the sand will go to the bottom and the water will be at the top. You can see right away that it's not the same throughout, no matter how much you shake it. Okay, eventually it'll settle down. Okay, milk doesn't settle down like that. Another example of a heterogeneous mixture would be ocean water or even the air we breathe. It changes all the time. It's different throughout. Okay, so keep that in mind. And this is nice. Compounds, for example, would be like, has to be two or more elements. So sodium chloride would be a great example, right? Or table salt. Okay, another example of a compound would be something you remember from biology. Glucose. Okay, great example of an element would be oxygen. Right, if it has the two there, it's still fluorine or hydrogen gas. These are all great elements, or even gold. That's the pure element, the pure substance. Okay, this is great. And so let's take a look at the next. Okay, and matter. So matter, as we said before, is solid, liquid, and gas. Okay, now there's three ways we could look at this. First, it's the element. The element or the atom is the single smallest unit, and it cannot be broken down further. The compound, on the other hand, is made up of fixed proportions, just like we saw with sodium chloride. Or another example, fixed proportions, right? One that we know very well is H2O, okay? That's a compound. And the compound can be broken up into elements, but the element cannot be broken down. I can't tell you how many times I've seen that on the true and false. Okay, and then finally we have a mixture, and this is made up of different compounds. So now we're just really going from the smallest to pretty much the largest, okay? And so we're keeping track of that. All right, very nice. And so the mixture, as we said before, is made up of many different compounds. Now, just to remind you about the mixtures, okay, same throughout. I put some homogeneous mixtures up here. This is just water, okay, coming through. Maybe that's salt water of some kind. Looks like water with something mixed in it. I have milk here. Okay, then we just see a key. Perhaps this key is made up of a certain type of metal. Okay, I'm gonna guess maybe iron or copper. And then, of course, we have this spoon. And the spoon is pulling, the spoon could be a homogeneous mixture because really, it's uniform throughout, but also this oil that it has. This looks like some sort of syrup. On the other hand, now this is a great like flaxseed mix, right? Some sort of granola or trail mix. This is definitely a heterogeneous mixture. Okay, now the metric system is the other thing you have to know in the SAT too. I had put some of the most common ones that we see, okay? Maybe we don't go as far as atto and femto, but what very important is what we have here, okay? So starting with the milli, all right, moving our way up to kilo. The basic metric system, you just wanna know. Okay, on the other hand, though, I've seen them put nanometers and picometers. Nanometers measure wavelength and light, right? And picometers measure the atomic radius, the distance between the furthest electron and the nucleus. And so you do have to know it, and so how to move the decimal point over. It's really just a game of decimals, and so you're counting on your way up. We remembered it like this, for starting with kilo and ending with milli, right? King Henry doesn't usually drink chocolate milk. Now, the one that's missing, of course, is the unit. The unit would go right there, okay? The unit, and that would be 10 to the 0 power. That would equal 1. The three units that you're going to see are grams, liters, okay, and meters. And so make sure you know those. They're going to be used with these prefixes. Okay, very nice. So know your metric system. Goes by tens. Okay, nice. Easy thing. It comes up once in a while, so it's not that major and important if you're having big problems with it. But this should have been tackled back a long time ago. And so in your future classes, this is going to be important as well. So make sure you get to know it. Okay, the other thing is significant figures. So how many decimal points should you put the answer? Okay, in a basic chemistry class, they go over significant figures. And here's the rules. Okay, so first, zeros between non-zeros are significant. So for example, in the number 504, there's three significant figures there. There's three, okay? Or let's say I put 1,000 or something like this, okay? So this would be 100,001 altogether. So there's how many sig figs? There's six significant figures. And so here we're gonna put four, and here there's six significant figures. Okay, and then so as long as we know that first rule, then the next rule is zeros in front of non-zeros are not significant. And so for example, I have a decimal here and I go like this. Okay, now how many significant figures is that? It's not four. The number of significant figures here is one. And the reason why it's only one is because you could put this in scientific notation, okay, and easily turn this into another number. You could turn this to 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, right? 8 times 10 to the -4. One significant figure standing on the left side of that 10. Okay, so that's only one significant figure. Zeros to the right of the decimal are significant though. So, for example, if it has a decimal, now this, don't get it confused with this. This is to the right of the decimal, but it says over here, zero's in front of a non-zero, right? What we're really talking about, so let's say, for instance, you wrote the number 1,000. Okay, for most purposes, that's only one significant figure. That's only one significant figure. But if I wrote the number 1,000 with the decimal right there, that shows a lot more precision in our answer. And so that's going to be four significant figures. Okay, so keep that in mind. Zeros to the right. So let's say, for instance, I wrote 10.000, just like that. Okay, then there's actually, those numbers are significant. That's five significant figures. However, if there's another number over there, okay, it's not significant. Zeros at the end of the number, but to the right of a decimal, are significant. Okay, zeros at the end of a number, okay, but to the right. And just that's what we had just said over here. Okay, so this looks great. Let's move on. Significant figures, they sometimes ask it. Make sure, okay, you go over these rules and make sure you know them. Next, physical change versus chemical change. Pretty simple stuff. If it's a physical change, the molecular structure remains exactly the same. Okay, so for example, this is ice melting, and it's just basically H2O solid becoming H2O liquid. So this is pretty simple, right? This is a physical change. It's still H2O. The molecule has not changed at all. On the other hand, this is some wood burning, okay? The wood is not gonna be the same chemical structure. It's gonna turn into carbon monoxide gas, carbon dioxide gas. It's also gonna turn into some ash, right? Some kind of carbonish ash. And so that's all gonna be totally different. The molecules are rearranged, okay? So remember, phase changes, physical change, ripping up a piece of paper, cracking this chalk in half, that's all physical change. Chemical change, okay, would be like if I threw this chalk in some acid, okay? Then it would change chemically. All right, great. Okay, so the other thing we have to know about the SAT too is the types of energy, right? So be aware, matter and energy, study of chemistry, right? So kinetic energy is moving energy. Potential energy is stored energy. We're gonna come across other chemical energies, right? Remember in biology there was ATP? That was considered chemical energy. Electrical energy, right? We're gonna do, we're gonna see some voltaic cells and electrochemical cells. So definitely we have to take charge of that. Okay, light energy is gonna become very important as well, because as electrons get excited on their way back down, they're gonna emit light, okay? And so we have to keep that in mind. Heat energy is gonna be measured a lot of times using the symbol Q, okay? And times we'll measure the heat of formation with enthalpy, right, delta H. All right, so heat of reaction, speaking of delta H, two kinds of reactions that we have. If it's endothermic, it absorbs energy, okay? And so this word comes up so many times, you just have to know it. And it gives you a positive delta H. So for example, as you can see in this graph, if these are the reactants, and here are the products, right? So we have the reactants over here, and the products over here. You could tell that it absorbed energy because the graph went up. Okay, now exothermic releases energy, and same thing goes over here, the reactants over here, the products over here, you could see that the energy went down, and so energy was lost or released, and that's a delta H of a minus. Okay, delta H, what is that? That's the change in enthalpy. Okay, that stands for enthalpy. Okay, very nice. And it measures the potential energy of the reaction. So let's take a look at how do we get delta H. Okay, so, get this out of here. Okay, so now I have exothermic reaction, okay, pretty simple. To remember what is delta H, let me just put the delta sign there. Okay, so delta H is equal to the potential energy of the products minus the potential energy of the reactants. So the way I remembered it was pepper, okay? Very simple, P-E-P-P-E-R, pepper. All right, and this is it right here. So this is the potential energy of the products is right here. And this distance over here is the potential energy of the reactants. Okay, and so what do you have? Delta H appears right there. Okay, nice and simple for you. And then so you see that this is gonna be just the difference between this minus this. Okay, and you should get a negative sign because it is exothermic. This number is smaller than that number. All right. Okay, so I think this concludes today's lecture. Chemistry SAT 2 lecture 1. All right, and next time we're going to go over the phases of matter. All right, but this is pretty much a very nice opening. One great thing to do is start looking at what an SAT 2 looks like, so you'll have a little bit of experience, okay? You might not know how to answer most of the questions or all of the questions, but that's okay. Just get used to the format and the level of difficulty. But some questions you will be able to answer, and every day you try, you're gonna be able to answer more and more questions. Okay, well, until next time, have a great day and be safe.